call the meeting to order. It is February 7th, 2018. It's 10 o'clock in the morning. We are the Regional Board, the Board of Regional Commissioners of Barnstable County Regional Government. And again, the clock is 10 o'clock. If you'd all join me, we are located at the Commissioners Meeting Room at the Superior Courthouse at 3195 Main Street in Barnstable. If you all join me to the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If you all could please remain standing for a moment of silence for all those who have died in the service of our country and for all those prayers for those who are currently serving. Thank you very much. For the record, is there anyone, members of the public, who are taping this meeting? And for the record, for those members of the public that are here, we are videotaping and audio taping you. Next up is number four, which is public comment. In the public comment session of our agenda, I just want to make the public aware of a couple of things. I set this aside on the agenda for you to come up and address the commissioners. However, we cannot engage in discussion back and forth on issues. So I want the members of the public to know that because you do not get a response from us, it does not mean that we hear what you're saying. And certainly if the issue warrants it, I'll be more than happy to put it on the agenda in a future date so that we could have an open discussion about it. I do note for the record, there is a substantial amount of members of the public here today, so I would ask you to keep your comments brief, and if at any point, if the number of you are here for the same subject, maybe you could have one of you come up and speak, and we'd be more than happy to take the names of the others that are here and include them in our minutes. They don't necessarily have to speak to be included in the minutes. So with that said, I'll open it up for public comment. Looking for someone to raise their hand first, or come on up. Great. And you do have to sit up here, and please tell us, for the record, your name, and if you could also fill out that sheet so that we get the spelling correct as we put it in our minutes.
Thank you. My name is Catherine Garofoli. I am a resident of Marston's Mills. I am former alumni of the Cape Cod AmeriCorps program and a former staff person of the Resource Development Office. I'm also a current service partner of the program. Thank you very much for allowing us to have this public comment today. For the last 19 years, Barnstable County government has been a leader in addressing Cape Cod's environmental and disaster preparedness needs by hosting the AmeriCorps program. This program is a nationally recognized community service program that attracts currently 32 members dedicated to serving their lives here to our 15 towns. That's over 3,700 conservation projects and the education of 57,000 of our students on Cape Cod about environmental issues, with over 500 alumni that have served our towns. And while supporting the problem, the program has its complexities and creates direct financial expense to Barnstable County required for the match of the federal money that we receive for it, the return on the investment of the program cannot be discounted. Since 1999, the AmeriCorps program has provided $24 million in community service values to our towns. That's 19 years of maintaining our natural areas that drive residents and visitors to live, play, and spend money here on Cape Cod. As you're aware, many people have been impacted by this program, and of the 500 alumni, 108 former members have stayed on Cape Cod or returned here after a time away. Currently, there's 50 alumni on the Cape in leadership roles making a difference for our county. This program has become our succession plan. This program brings young people to come and serve here, gain professional experience, and want to stay. Recently, service partners and alumni became aware that Barnstable County government will no longer provide housing at its property in Bourne for this program. This causes great concern from service partners to alumni alike. One reason this program is successful is due to the residential component. The high cost of living on Cape Cod would make it impossible for an individual member to live here on a biweekly stipend of $277. If housing is not found to substantiate the match for federal grants, it puts the program at risk. It also impacts the distribution of service to Upper Cape communities. If housing is not found on the Upper Cape to evenly distribute members across the region, the financial and resource burden it would have on the program would be immense. I was happy and encouraged to hear from Mr. Kokonis yesterday by phone that the Barnstable County Administration is committed to finding alternative housing and has included that in its budget. This is also something that the advisory board is concerned about as well. The advisory board and service partners and alumni would like to be part of the solution. We will be reaching out to you in the next couple of days to set up a meeting to talk about the future of housing for the AmeriCorps program. I do have 12 impact statements submitted from service partners and alumni that I'd like to issue for the record about the support of this program.
You can leave them there. We'll have Owen pick them up.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I appreciate your time this morning, and I wouldn't be here if it wasn't deeply important to the local community that this program continues. And I'm hopeful that we can come to a cooperative solution together to make this happen. I know that there are a number of people here today that have other things to say, and if you would like to take their names, that would be great. I do appreciate the service that you provide to our county, and I appreciate you for your time today. Thank you very much.
And for the record, and for those people at home, the AmeriCorps program starts in August and runs the following end of July, or I should say August to August. In our budget, we do anticipate still having the AmeriCorps program, and yes, we are looking, and for those of you watching at home, we are looking for some housing opportunities, especially down in the Lower Cape area, and we have until now, until next August, to find that housing. So, Upper Cape. We have Lower Cape. I always get it confused. Anyone else would like to come up? And if we do have a sign-up sheet here that I will offer those who are here on the AmeriCorps issue, if you would like to just sign the register and spell your name correctly for us, we'll be very happy to include that in the minutes so you can show that you've turned out today. Yes, ma'am, come on up. Okay. For the record, yes.
Okay.
For the record,
should I sit here?
Please.
Okay.
And for the record, you just have to tell us your name, and I guess you weren't here for the introduction. But I don't want you to think that we are rude. This is public comment, and we do not interact in a discussion back and forth.
Understood.
Okay.
Thank you. For the record, my name is Jessica Rittenauer. I'm the executive director of the 300 Committee Land Trust of Falmouth. I was a member of AmeriCorps Cape Cod from 2002 to 2003, and I've served on the AmeriCorps Cape Cod Advisory Board since 2006. And I just want to share impact statement from the Upper Cape region specifically, and acknowledge all of the work on the Cape, but I wanted to make sure that we could provide a voice for the Upper Cape. Of the public services that have been provided have been a tremendous value to Barnstable County since the program's founding in 1999. The program has addressed critical land and water conservation needs through more than 3,700 projects, advanced disaster preparedness and response activities through marine mammal stranding responses, support for regional emergency shelters, and leading more than 500 disaster preparedness classes, and engaged more than 57,000 students in environmental education activities. Estimated value of the AmeriCorps Cape Cod services exceeds $24 million. I want to say that the value to Barnstable County far exceeds the financial investment. The positive impact and the benefits to the school children, our natural resources, and our community disaster response makes all of our communities stronger. The commitment and investment that's been made by Barnstable County government has provided the backbone of support for the program for 18 years. The federal match of 52% of the program budget, combined with the county's 48% match, is a winning formula. We know that the county match portion relies on the housing component in Bourne and Wellfleet as a critical part of the formula. The location of the housing on the outer and the Upper Cape really enables the members to provide dedicated service in all 15 towns. The loss of the Bourne house would create an urgent need for the program to locate another housing option. So urging the county commissioners to stand firmly behind the AmeriCorps program by investing your resources and your commitment towards meeting the urgent need of the AmeriCorps Cape Cod program, and by continuing to support the budgeted funds that the county provides as part of the local match for the program. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your time. Anybody else? Yes, sir, in the middle. I'm sorry, ma'am.
Good morning. I appreciate the opportunity to address the county commissioners this morning. My name is Rachel Hutchinson. I am a full-time resident of the town of Brewster. I'm also an alumni of the AmeriCorps Cape Cod program. I did not grow up on the Cape, but I did spend many summers here in high school and through college working summer jobs on Cape. I have always been drawn to Cape Cod, and as long as I can remember, but I never thought I'd be able to make Cape Cod home. I arrived on Cape Cod as an AmeriCorps member 12 years ago in 2005, directly after graduate school. I was looking for a direction and something to help me steer my future career. I had been offered a job with the federal government at that time, but I was looking for something different. As I was looking once again, I was drawn to Cape Cod. I only had a passing knowledge of the AmeriCorps program and of the Cape Cod program specifically, but the opportunity to serve my country and to give a year to a place I loved was a chance I couldn't give up. One of the biggest advantages of the AmeriCorps Cape Cod program was the fact the program provided housing for all of its members. Even without the intimate knowledge that I now have of the Cape, I knew that attempting to find housing while serving on AmeriCorps stipend would be nearly impossible. With one house in Wellfleet and one house in Bourne, the program offers the opportunity to equally cover all the Cape Cod towns and allow the members the opportunity to equally serve across the entire Cape Cod region. After my year of service as a member of AmeriCorps Cape Cod, I left the Cape to move west to complete a second year of national service. However, as I left and drove across the Sagamore Bridge, my goal was to return to Cape Cod. I knew I'd be back. I spent the year out west with my eyes peeled to job postings on Cape Cod, and in July 2007, I was lucky enough to be hired full-time year-round by one of the municipalities. As I scrambled to move back, my biggest concern was where I would live. Lucky to have extended family on the Cape, I was able to couch surf for 2 months until I was able to secure a rental. Since then, I have been lucky enough to become a homeowner in Brewster, a task not easily achieved by a young professional, but with 2 full-time jobs and 4 part-time jobs between my partner and I, we have made it work. I have now become one of the young people that is staying on the Cape. One of the demographics that the CCYP noted in 2015 was fleeing the Cape at an alarming number, down 27% from 2000 to 2010 in the 25 to 44 age group. When CCYP conducted their Shape the Cape study in 2015, they noted that housing and jobs were the 2 major factors contributing to the fleeing of the young demographic. AmeriCorps Cape Cod has been bucking that trend. Of the other over 500 members that have contributed over $24 million worth of service directly to Barnstable County, over 50 alumni now live and work on Cape Cod. Like you can see in this room, many of these alumni hold positions of powers within towns, land trusts, and local nonprofits. Most of us are active in our community, holding multiple board positions within towns, land trusts, nonprofits, and community organizations. We are your teachers, directors, constables, scientists, firefighters, administrators, and agents within your community. We have built a life here on the Cape, and AmeriCorps Cape Cod opened that door and allowed us to make that life in Barnstable County. As county commissioners, you are tasked to uphold the mission of Barnstable County to promote and sustain the proactive open government and enhances the quality of life for the citizens of Barnstable County. AmeriCorps Cape Cod plays an integral role in this mission, from the direct service they complete to the current residents of Barnstable County, to the future alumni who may choose to remain in Barnstable County. This program is vital. As commissioners, I implore you to look at the bigger picture, look beyond the dollar value printed on the page of the budget, and look for the value and the worth of this program in enhancing the quality of life for the citizens of Barnstable County. Barnstable County should be doing everything within its power not to cut, but to grow the program, to support the program in securing appropriate, reliable housing for its incoming members, one who may be sitting in your chair and serve as county commissioner. Thank you.
Thank you. Amy? And Amy, if you could do me a favor, if you are the last speaker anyhow, take that sheet with you and make sure that anyone wants to sign it outside, they can.
Sure.
because we'll wait till we get outside, because you can sign it now. But I'm just going to let the other people know that I'm going to have that sheet outside on the desk, at the counter, so that you won't have to write on it in your lap. You know.
Is Peter Kenny going to talk?
I'm not done yet. Go for it.
Good morning, commissioners, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today. My name is Amy Usowski, and I'm the conservation administrator for the town of Harwich. I was also a year 8 member of the Wellfleet House in AmeriCorps. Not only was I a member, but I've had the privilege of being involved in this program ever since. I can tell you what the program has done for me personally, what an integral part it is to the Cape community. This program attracts educated, top-notch young men and women from around the country. They come with drive and ambition and more than a little energy to do nothing but good for our community. We teach them the skills on how to do land and water resource management, prepare for and respond to disasters, and educate the community on the importance of a healthy environment. They receive almost a year's worth of invaluable experience that they either take with them elsewhere after bettering the country, or they make their lives here on the Cape and continue to benefit our community. The impact multiplies. Since my time as a member, I have had the privilege to receive individual placements and work with the houses as a whole on group service projects. As the head of the Conservation Department for the town of Harwich, I can honestly tell you we would not have been able to accomplish half of what we have been able to do without AmeriCorps assistance. We have restored critical habitats, cleaned up our waterways, and educated people, young and old, about how important it is to care for our environment. We depend on them. The Cape Cod community depends on them. Being able to cover the needs across the entire Cape has been one of the pillars of this program. It has also been a model for how a countywide program can work. Reduction in the number of members due to lack of housing will directly impact every single town on the Cape. Competition for group projects will increase. We already have to apply far in advance to get group service. Work will not get done. The towns simply do not have the staffing. Administration, police, fire, and schools get the majority of town funding because they are basic necessities. However, it is our natural resources that bring people to the Cape. Our economy is directly tied to the quantity and quality of our natural areas. AmeriCorps members provide an invaluable service to both the health of our environment and to the Cape Cod community. Having houses on both ends of the Cape works. It has been proven to work. It does not need adjusting. I am so proud of this program, as should you be. You are not just investing in the program and of these members, but in the future of the Cape. I ask you to reconsider your decision to no longer use the Bourne House for the housing of members, or that you commit to assist the program and to your highest ability to find other adequate housing on the Upper Cape. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Last call for AmeriCorps, people that would like to speak. All right, seeing none, I had a gentleman walked in, I think, before I announced the open public comment. Oh, Mr. Kenny, I think he's out in the hall. Can you ask Mr. Kenny, are you here for public comment?
Yes.
Why don't you come in now, sir, then?
Morning.
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 Well, 'tis the season. Budget.
I know who you are, but people watching at home. And
my name is Peter Kenny. I'm from West Yarmouth.
Thank you.
I have here a copy of the Cape Cod Commission payroll. It's interesting. We have an average or median household income on Cape Cod of $66,970. And we have an average pay at the Cape Cod Commission of $85,000. $85,000. An average pay for staff at the Cape Cod Commission. That's one person. That's not a household. That's 66. One of the principal reasons for the Cape Cod Commission's current financial dilemma is that there's no fee income. There are no applicants. There's one DCPC, there are no DRIs, there's no business. And the reason is that there's a big sign at the Cape Cod Canal that most people can't see. But corporate executives, development officers, property managers for corporations can see it. It says, go away. don't bother. I personally had a conversation with the senior vice president of the Raytheon Corporation several years ago about why they did not follow through on an intended plan to build a campus down here. And he said, look, we're Raytheon. We don't have to care what it costs. We do, but we don't have to. But we would like it done in our lifetime. And we've never seen a permitting process like this. We design radar systems that can track anything, anywhere, anytime. We just don't want to deal with this. Now, I have a specific question. There's an economic chief economic development officer, who's paid $85,074.55 a year. Point of order, Mr. Chairman, what does she do?
Well, as I said before you came in, Mr. Kenny, there's no interaction between you and
I. Understand, but I want that question on the record.
Fine, we'll be happy to get your job
what
description.
What does, not a job description, I'd like to see results, I'd like to see a performance report. What does she do all day long? Is anyone at the Cape Cod Commission on the phone trolling for business? Are they talking to the large real estate brokerages in Boston, asking if any locations from Lexington would choose to come here, as was the case with Raytheon, who wanted to move a major division from their headquarters, where they thought there was just too much staff interference department to department, to the Cape? We blew it. This payroll is disgraceful. It's absolutely disgraceful. The towns pay to them. Applicants pay to them. They have grant income. And then they come to the county. That was never the plan. It was never advertised or intended that the Cape Cod Commission would ever have to come to the county of Barnstable and ask for additional funding. It was never on the boards. But it happens every single year. And now, they even want to charge for services they provide the county. They're an agency of this county government. That's how they're defined in law. That's how they're defined in law. This law. My final comment. From page one of an act establishing the Cape Cod Commission. They're responsible for a balanced economic growth, the provision of adequate capital facilities, including transportation, water supply, and solid, sanitary, and hazardous waste disposal facilities, the coordination of the provision of adequate capital facilities with the achievement of other goals, the development of an adequate supply of fair housing, and the preservation of historical, cultural, and archaeological recreational values. They're also responsible for enhancing sound local and regional economies and to ensure balanced economic development. They even out the high spots and the low spots of the Cape Cod seasonal economy. Rhetorical question, I understand there won't be any interaction, Mr. Chairman, but can somebody in this room tell me how that's going? I would like to know. I would like to know why we have available lots in Independence Park, a stone's throw from here. But if you duck, you don't get hit. I would like to know, with this outrageous, outrageous payroll, substantially more than the average or median Cape Cod household, not individual, household, why do we tolerate this? This is a rogue agency. There is clearly no control. There is clearly no oversight. There's clearly no reporting. There are clearly no standards for performance. There are clearly no expectations. So we get what we expect. We can get the same thing for nothing. We don't have to spend a few million bucks a year. We can get it for nothing. So, with all due respect, commissioners, something has to change. $179,000 a year, which was what we were paying, plus benefits. I hope we can get a hold of an executive director who will get those people moving. I have been part of and I have run, managed large construction crews for years. Everything from the World Trade Center, Tower 1, to houses on Nantucket. And if I come to a housing project and I don't hear hammers and nails and saws, something's wrong. I see a whole bunch of trucks and a lot of people on the payroll, but I don't hear anything happening. This is a clue. And I don't hear anything happening. We've got a jail up here that's been empty now for how long? It was planned to be empty for the past 20 years. People knew it was going to be empty. It's still empty. And look what we have for a meeting facility for the government. Thank you, Cape Cod Commission. I've had it. And I personally am going to start making noise about this. I'm going to publish these numbers and make sure everybody on the Cape knows that down in that rented building in Barnstable Village, we have 30-some people who are better than everybody else. I mean, the idea that they would say they're going to work in the morning is a joke.
Thank you for your time, Mr. Kennedy.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can you do me a favor? There's no one else planning on speaking. Can you do me a favor, Mr. Kennedy, to take that sheet with you and put it on the desk outside?
Okay.
Thank you, Jeff.
Okay.
Anybody who's leaving would like the name on the record. I'm going to have that sheet outside, and you can just sign it out there. I know that I said earlier there won't be any interaction between the county commissioners and the members of the public, but I just will want to inform people of a statement that we just made that the jail is empty. The jail is not empty. The jail has a lovely meeting room. We also have the health department up there that has been operating up there for many years. And we also have offices in the center portion of the building. And we are currently in the construction phase of building yet again another larger meeting room and office space on the left wing. So that's just for the record. With that said, I thank everyone for their time today and their patience with us and in the process. And we're going to move on to the number 5 on the agenda, which is the minutes. I understand, Ron, you might have some question. These are the minutes of January 31st, 2018, which was really the meeting that we began the budget presentations and votes, I should say. So I think you said you had some questions. Did you want to postpone this?
Yeah, I just want to put it off for a week because I did, when I was reading it over last night, there were some errors.
Not a problem.
So if we just get that squared away.
And I would be appreciate. I looked through it and thought it was okay, but I am also concerned that because there were some votes taken, make sure that the language is correct before we publish the minutes. So thanks. We will postpone then the minutes of January 31st, 2018 till next week. That brings us to number 6, which is the budget review and budget workshop, I should say. And to make this go easier, my fellow commissioners, I'm going to be working off of this sheet here today. You don't have to have your big budget books in front of you. Basically, what this sheet reflects is the adjustments that we voted last week and also some minor adjustments that came to the attention of staff because of either miscalculations or some small adjustments back and forth. So basically, what I'm going to do is go down each one of these and I'm going to see if there's any further adjustments. So in other words, if you don't have any amendments, basically we don't have to say anything. And by that virtue, we will be approving the number which is on your far right on this sheet and directly across from the department, which is on the left side. So let's do the first one first so we can see how I'm going to do this. The first one is county commissioners. You will notice that there is a number of adjustments. Those were all approved last week and instructed staff to do them. The new number that we're looking at is $774,778. Are there any further adjustments or corrections to that line item? Seeing none, we will go to the next one. Information technology. Once again, you do see that there was adjustments. Those adjustments are specifically related to the vote taken by this board to instruct staff to reallocate monies in the joint initiative line item. So we are funding it, we're just funding it under a different line item. The new number is $1,293,503. Are there any...
That's for information technology?
Yes. Okay. Any changes or questions there? None. Okay. 110 is resource development. There was a minor clerical change, and the new number is $662,769. Is there any further adjustments or changes to that number? Seeing none, we're going to go to the next one.
Just real quick, that includes the AmeriCorps budget?
That includes the AmeriCorps budget. The AmeriCorps has been funded here. So
yeah. Okay.
Please understand that. We have a question from staff. Yes. I will not take comments from the public, by the way. Staff is more than welcome. But I will not take any more input from the public.
Yeah, this is just on the budget.
Right.
So on the RDO adjustment, was it the 2,200 that was added, Mary?
17
is being added based on actuals for the last 12 months
for
and
an
estimate by IT of the expenses
okay.
for those two locations.
Okay, perfect. Thank
All
you.
Right.
You're welcome.
You okay with that?
Yep.
I should have read the adjustment, but I thought you guys were on board with it.
That's fine. Thank
okay.
you.
Okay, great. Now we're on the Assembly of Delegates. Assembly of Delegates has, once again, a number of additions and subtractions. Those were all relative to the discussions that we had last week. Finance and staff has made those corrections. The new number is $248,521. Does anyone have any adjustments or amendments to that number?
Yes.
Okay.
I propose to reduce the in-state travel line item by $7,500, which would take it down to $10,000.
Okay. For the record, I'm going to read a motion into the record that says, I move to amend line item 130 of the Assembly by removing $7,500 from line 5282, in-state travel. The proposed amount is $17,500. The new amount will be $10,000.
So moved.
So that's been moved. Do I have a second on that? What?
Is it $7,500 or $17,500? This sheet looks like $7,500.
No, that's a dollar sign.
Right.
So it's $7,500.
Right. So he said $17,000.
That's the
total.
Okay.
Minus
the total presently in the line item
in
is $17,500.
Okay.
And we're removing $75,000, which leaves a total of $10,000
for in-state travel.
Okay. For in-state travel. Do you want to second that?
Oh, for discussion.
Yep. Okay, Ron, why?
They use that both for mileage reimbursement as well as the paying for the MMA conference. And I think that in last year, when we were having even more problems, it was increased by $2,000 from 15.5 up to 17.5. So I'm just putting it back down to what it was 2 years ago. No, excuse me. I'm bringing it down. I think that they can live without, you know, if they want to go to the MMA conference or if their clerk wants to, maybe they can pick up the tab for the hotel and stuff.
Okay. Well, you do know that in the line item under, I think there's one more in there, that education of employees is $2,400, which is actually for the registration of MMA. So although the $7,500 in the line item that you picked out is for not only the mileage of the delegates going back and forth, but it is to reimburse, if you will, the assembly members for their MMA conference and their parking. I'm on board with you 100% on this one, although I don't know if I want to remove all of it. I have a problem with members of the assembly going for 3 days. I have a problem with members of the assembly and anyone, not just the assembly, any of us going and having every single meal picked up and also the parking. It is an expensive, it has become an expensive trip. Again, I kind of wish I had done some more legwork on it. I have no problems with paying the registration for MMA, nor would I have a problems with paying for like one night and the meals that MMA actually puts on. But I do have a problem with people submitting lunches from the top of the hub.
Right.
You know, so not that they do that.
This still leaves $10,000 in that account. And for people not familiar, MMA is the Massachusetts Municipal Association conference and trade show. It's held every January in Boston. So,
do you have any input on this?
Yes. I would like to say that the MMA meeting is the... It's not the only meeting that MMA has, but it's the only meeting that it has that brings together the employees, the municipal employees from around the state. The programs that they provide, for the most part, address many of the functions of government in the state. And it gives our people here in the county the opportunity to not only participate in the educational programs, but also to be able to participate and meet this people who have similar positions, although there are not that many county governments in the state. Actually, there aren't any except for us. But it gives them the opportunity to meet people who work for other municipalities. And it's once a year. It has educational opportunities in the programs that are offered. It allows them to mix with people from other communities. And it really is, it's an opportunity to let them grow and understand more about their own position in their own government and be able to bring that information back and make it useful in their deliberations as well as in their relationships with the other members of the assembly. We don't, as a rule, have a fund that provides this kind of opportunity to county employees, or either elected or appointed. We have a budget for that because it's important. And I don't think to cut back on that, since it's so it isn't that great anyway and doesn't afford all those opportunities, but it affords the right opportunities to the right people. So I would not support decreasing this budget for this educational purpose.
So, okay. To add one thing, I believe that in light of the dire financial challenges that Barnstable County government's been facing and continues to face for the foreseeable future, that this, though a small reduction, it at least indicates that we are cognizant that it's really a luxury that we can't afford. It doesn't prevent anybody from attending the conference. Like you said, we still cover the registration costs and whatnot, but you know, somebody goes up there for more than a day, or you know, and takes in other activities, then it should be, they can certainly do so at their own cost. So I think that the $7,500 reduction is more than justified.
I'm gonna go with Mary Pat on this one.
Okay.
And I just want to give my explanation why. I really believe that the county needs to have policies and procedures in place on who uses this kind of service. And as I mentioned before, it needs to be clear what we will reimburse people for and not for. And without that in place right now, I cannot comfortably say that the remaining $10,000 is enough to pay for at least one night. And the registration, well, I mean, the registration fee is paid for, but one night and the reimbursement for mileage, and I don't want to just throw a number out for throwing a number out for the sake of throwing it out. Thank you for bringing it up. Don't let us forget it, and let us put it on the agenda for a full discussion. So we have a policy in place for our department heads. And our employees, when they go to things, they come back here and they report to us on what they learned and what they shared, and they bring us back little things, because I insist on it. Maybe we should, you know, have that same kind of a thing for any members that are using county funds to attend educational things. So at this point, I'm not going to support the motion.
So just to clarify, this is specifically for the legislative branch of, you know, the elected officials in our legislative branch, the County Assembly of Delegates. It's not for county employees, except possibly for the clerk to the assembly. I'm not
that is
believe
correct.
That it covers that particular individual, but other county employees are covered from other areas of the.
They're covered from other areas, and we have a policy and procedure in place that requires those members that do take advantage of it to come here and report to us.
Okay.
That's why it's my wish that we put this back on the agenda specifically, talk about it specifically, put together a policy and procedure for elected officials when they take advantage of monies put aside for educational purposes.
Do you think it'd be appropriate to bring it up at the time that the assembly takes up the budget on this particular item? Maybe we could have a discussion.
I think they're going to know that you made the motion. It's going to be in the record, and I think people will be talking about it. So
very good.
So I'm going to put it to a vote. All those in favor?
I just want to ask him to make the motion again.
So I will read it for you. It says that he's.
Let's
take it. It's on here. I'm going to vote it. I got it. Don't screw up my paperwork now, please. I move to amend the line 130 assembly by removing $7,500 from line item 5282 in-state travel. The proposed amount is $17,500. The new amount would be $10,000.
Yes.
He's saying yes.
No.
No. Does not pass.
Okay.
So I'm going to put out for discussion again now. Wait a minute. One, two. The line item for the assembly is $248,521. Is there any other discussion on that line item?
No.
No? You're happy with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's go to the next one. Finance, the number is $674,034. Is there any discussion, additions, or changes that people want to entertain there? Hearing none? No. Cooperative extension. The number is $2,420,109. Facilities. I'm sorry, facilities. I have to get a ruler.
Yeah, it is.
I'm going to use this piece of paper here. Thank you. I got it. I have it. We did finance. Now we're doing facilities. It was the right number, wrong department. Facilities, $2,420,109. Anything on facilities? No? Okay, let's go to the next one then. By not taking action, we basically are approving it. I just don't want to be writing the 15 motions that we're approving these numbers. We'll make the approval at the bottom when staff adds them all up. Now we're at cooperative extension. The number is $2,228,294. Any the changes in that?
No.
No? Ron?
No.
Okay. Registry of Deeds. The number is $2,568,210. Registry of Deeds, anybody? Okay. Dredge. The dredge does have an amendment that was put in by our request last week. The new number for the dredge is $2,026,000. Is there any other additions other than the ones that have been factored in for the dredge?
No.
Okay. Next, joint initiatives. That number is zero. We took it out of the budget as an action last week, but you have seen how we have redistributed the monies in the proper accounts so that they are being, portions anyhow, in this budget are being, reflected. So,
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
So in other words, we're eliminating the line item.
Yes.
But we're not eliminating funding for the joint initiatives because they're incorporated in other parts of the budget.
Thank you.
Okay.
That's one of them just did, actually, above it, the 50 for what do you call it.
I just wanted to make that clear.
Okay. Health and environment. Health and environment has a small adjustment to it, which was we asked in last week's meeting. I believe this reflects positions which are not presently occupied by a body.
It was a placeholder?
Thank you. That's the term we used. The number is $3,675,830, and that is the new adjusted number. Any other corrections or additions to that line item?
Mm-mm.
Okay. Human services. The number is $1,250,062. Does anybody have an emotion for this one?
I do. Desire,
I should say. I have the motion if you want me to.
Yeah, I need to revisit the $20,000 reduction you proposed last week because I studied it more and...
Well, let's put it on the floor and we'll talk about it.
Okay.
I'm looking for someone to move to amend line 310, Human Services, by removing $20,000 from line item 5239, Professional Technical Services. The proposed amount is $98,000. The new amount will be $78,000. Do you want to make that motion?
So moved.
Would you like to second it for discussion?
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. It's on the floor for discussion. Ron?
Yeah, since the discussion we had last week, I happen to remember that, though I'm very supportive of the My Choice program, which has to do with addressing the opioid epidemic and drug addiction issues in general, my recollection was it's supposed to be I believe it was almost totally grant funded, and these funds are coming out of the county revenues of the county budget. So I couldn't, after giving it further thought, I can't really justify taking another $20,000 out of county revenues towards something that is supposed to be grant dependent. It essentially funds probably other things, but radio ads, and so on and so forth.
Print
so.
Ads.
Yeah. So
this is the one that we talked about last week. I actually made the motion last week, and it did not pass. It was you two voted against it 2-1, and Ron has brought it up again. It's again specific to the line item on the human services, and it reduces it by 20 grand. So
what it will actually do is keep it level funded from what it was last year. It just won't let it increase. So it's not. In reality, it's not a cut. It's just level funding it from FY18.
Actually, I believe it is up still a little bit more from FY18, by not much though. I can give you the exact amount if you're interested. But.
I think we should.
Last year was funded 76,000. And this year, the new number is going to be 78,000. I'm sorry, it's about $1,200. $76,788, okay. And this year we're going to 78. So you're only putting about $1,200 in it, just for the record. Yeah. So, any further discussion on this?
Well, I just wanted to say that I think that the human services area of the county is one of the really more important services that we provide to Barnesville County. I mean, there's not a lot when you have home rule like we have here in Massachusetts, where the towns actually can tax their homeowners or property owners pretty much as they need and as they can and as the property owners will sustain. Nevertheless, since we have no governing authority over the towns, one of the major objectives of the county is to provide the kind of services that the towns need. Or at least need more support with. So I think human services is one of those. And I think that any time that there's an opportunity and we have the resources, that we should really fund these services for the betterment of the community. So I support it.
You don't support the amendment, though?
The amendment, yeah.
Okay, because he's looking to remove it, so you're going to be
no
vote.
I don't support the amendment.
Okay. Anybody else want to weigh in on this in staff, or do you want to let it go to the assembly? No? Okay, let's put it to a vote then. All in favor?
Yes.
Aye.
No.
Okay, staff, can you please make the reduction of $20,000 from that line item, and when you bring back the final document, reflect that. The new number now is going to be... All right, let's see where the hell we are now. I got to get this line straight. 1,230,062.
How much?
1,230,062, because we reduced it by 20.
Okay.
Okay, next is Children's Cove. The number is 842,848. Any further reductions or additions, subtractions? Children's Cove. Hearing none, I'm going to move on. Public Safety, 1,506,576. Any reductions, changes, additions, complaints? Hearing none?
Yeah.
No, I'm not going to let you complain. Fire Training Academy, $431,367. Any other changes, reductions, additions to that? Hearing none, right? Yeah. Moving on. Cape Cod Commission, the new number is $6,054,749.
Well,
looking for Gail.
She's here.
Thank you. Okay, that shows, you know, the anticipated things that we asked for, and certainly staff is all met and knows what's going on here, so.
No, I'm all set.
Okay, next. Fringe benefit line item, $1,232,428. Seeing nothing. Our miscellaneous contingencies, $697,625. Hearing nothing from my fellow board members. Make sure you jump up if you're going to do something. Debt services, $812,410.
So this includes the lawsuit with the town of Barnstable,
yes.
Settlement?
Yes.
And how much of that is, do we know roughly what percentage of this is the town of Barnstable lawsuit?
The town of Barnstable costs inside of the debt service budget are about
$185,000. $185,000, $195,000
around that area? Yeah. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Really? I thought it was more.
So that's good. Well, there are other costs.
But
they're not
debt service.
The debt service
is strictly principal and interest.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, SRF funding. 2%.
Yeah.
Appropriated reserves, we have zero. Is there anything, additions or changes?
So
okay.
So we're not putting any money away in reserves this year?
Not in the budget.
Okay. Oh, we wait till it's reconciled, like, for example, FY17 and all?
Mary McGuizik will be bringing in something.
Okay.
The closing of the books delivers an increase to unreserved fund balance, which could then be further distributed to reserves by your vote.
Okay, thank you. So our total is just going to be minus the 20,000?
Yes.
So you're figuring it out.
Yeah, the new total is $29,380,113. Subject to approval of staff. That's what I'd be looking for, a motion.
We would confirm the number, but we would respectfully request a separate motion for the Dredge Enterprise Fund.
This is just for?
Dredge Enterprise is in the 29 million. We'll give you the numbers for the split for the ordinances.
Please. Yes, this is just the to finish up our workshop.
Yep.
You're gonna go out and come back with the split numbers that we will officially be voting later on.
We'll prepare the ordinances and bring them back to you.
Yeah.
Okay.
So right now I'm just looking for a combined kind of...
of $29,380,113.
Subject to staff's approval.
Review.
Okay.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. You have your walking papers. For those of you that are listening at home or paying attention, and for those of you that care, we will be voting later on the actual ordinances that are going to be going over to the Assembly of Delegates and that are going to be the official budget. Staff is leaving now to take our voted changes and recommendations, and we'll come back with those accurate numbers, and we will be voting the actual ordinances. So. In case you're following at home. All right. General business. The two things that we have first coming up in general business is a discussion and a proposed memorandum of understanding between Barnstable County and the Cape Cod Commission regarding dredge. And then the second one is a discussion and a proposed memorandum of understanding regarding the expansion or expanding and dealing with the information technology and communications. I am going to ask that my fellow commissioners take these documents and go home and read them over. However, I would caution you that I particularly don't care for them, and there's a couple of reasons, and I'm just going to say this publicly, because I'd like to bring back yet again maybe a third version or a version that we can all have a consensus on, and that would be something that is not so specific. I was looking for more of a memorandum of understanding between the agency, Cape Cod Commission, the agency, and Barnstable County government as a general understanding on how we're going to work with each other in the future. These were too specific for me, and I apologize. I did not have the time to sit down with staff this week to bring my thoughts into them. But I just believe, I don't have anything wrong with these specifically, other than the fact that they're too specific in an agreement, and that's not what I was looking for. I was looking for more of a general understanding on how we're going to move forward and deal, the two agencies deal together. So I'll put both of these on the table for discussion if you guys have any questions or comments on it, but I will tell you that they will be back relatively soon.
Okay, I'm fine with that.
Either in their entirety or separately as one agreement. Okay, but if you take a chance to look them over, you'll at least understand, I hope anyhow, you'll understand what I'm talking about. And
yep.
If you'd rather go this way, then...
So the dredge is pretty much the permitting portion of it?
Well, that's again, I personally don't believe that a memorandum of understanding should tie the hands of the both organizations to a specific thing. You know, if we're going to ask the Cape Cod Commission to help us with permitting, well, they're actually helping the towns with permitting. But they will be doing a service for us by compiling those permits and then maybe, I don't know, once a month sit down and say, okay, this is the best way for the dredge to move forward because these permits are up at hand. All that doesn't need to be in the memorandum of understanding.
No, but
that's my point.
But as far as the dredge, it's chiefly
yes.
what you they
yes.
were going to do, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay,
so I'm going to put A and B. I'm going to put a hold on A and B and come back and revisit them. I'm going to ask also that we skip C and D right now because staff just went out to put together the correct numbers for the proposed ordinance for the operating budget and for the operating budget of the dredge. So with your indulgence, I'm going to go right to Commissioner's Actions, which is number 9.
So we'll take these up next week?
No, they're going to come back with numbers in a minute.
Oh, come back later.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Mary's just taking those numbers and... going and putting together the actual ordinance. Number 9 is approval of a timesheet. I'm looking for someone to move to authorize the approval of the timesheet of Jack Eunice, County Administrator, for the period of January 21st, 2018 through February 3rd, 2018, as presented.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any questions on this?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Authorization of execution of a contract. I'm looking for someone to move to authorize the execution of a contract for a grant from the Massachusetts Department of Children's and Families to Children's Cove in the amount of $140,000 for a period of July 1st, 2017 through June 30th, 2018 to provide services to families as presented.
So moved.
Second question.
Yep.
I have
yes.
a question. Stacy's here.
Yep.
I wanted to ask, how different is this grant from last year? Is it more or less?
It's the same.
What?
It's the same.
Okay.
Same amount.
All right. That's all I needed to know.
And then while you're here, Stacy, the dates on this are correct from July 1st, 2017 to June 30th, 2018. Okay. I'm getting a nod.
The governor just released the money.
Yep.
I have a quick question. Do grants like these get reviewed by your advisory board? No?
No, so that's our state earmark.
Okay, thank you.
Great. By the way, the answer was no, it's a state earmark, for those of you listening at home that maybe couldn't hear Ms. Gallagher from the back of the room. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, we have another grant authorization. I'm looking for someone to authorize the execution of a contract. I'm sorry, it's not a grant, it's a contract. Amendment for a grant. From the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, through the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute, WOI, to Cape Cod Cooperative Extension in the amount of $679,582 for the period of February 1st, 2014 through August 31st, 2018. To fund the Sea Grant Extension Program, extending the period of the performance from January 31st, 2018 through August 31st, 2018, changing the grant principal investor as presented. We have somebody here, so somebody put it on the floor.
I have a question.
Well, we have to put it on the floor first.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved by Ron, seconded by Ms. Flynn. Who wants to go first? Why don't we let Ms. Flynn go first? Go for it.
I have a question related to... the, let's see, grant. How does, the grant was extended from January of 18 through August of 18. How does this change it for you in terms of the funding? The funding, I'm assuming, didn't change, or maybe it did. So how do you work through that?
Mike McGuire, Director of Cape Cod Cooperative Extension. So the easiest way to explain this is we have an existing four-year contract with Woods Hole Sea Grant. This is a no-cost extension. So we have funds that are still available. The funder will allow us to continue to build them, but we have to amend the contract from January 1st later so we can keep spending those funds. The total overall award is the same. And the principal investigator that was changed is a Sea Grant staff. It went from Judy McDowell to Matt Charette. So it was just the technical correction in the document.
And this includes the, I think, half the funding for Greg Berman's position?
For the coastal geologist, and for there's three staff, half of their funding comes from that grant. And we'll be receiving a new four-year grant this spring that will continue. That'll be the new contract from Sea Grant. But these funds, we still have funds left, and they want us to spend them. So they're requesting a date change so that we can keep spending that money.
It sounds funny that the way you put it, but anyway. Okay, thanks.
That's the way the government works, man. They give you so much money, and they authorize you a time frame to spend it. And right. If you don't spend it, they're nice enough to say, we're going to give you it a little bit longer. They
and
could
is,
say, no, we're
like
going to take
really
it back.
This is a really great thing for us.
Yeah, so they could say, we want the balance, and you're right. going to allocate it to something else.
Right.
So,
yeah,
so this is a what we call in the farm a no-brainer.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All right. Okay, that brings us to D, which is a creation of a new fund for contract. I'm looking for someone to move to authorize the creation of a new fund for a contract for a grant from the Cape Cod Healthcare to the Department of Health and Environment in the amount of $1,350 for the period of January 19, 2018 through October 31st, 2018 to support the Cape Cod Medical Reserve Corp with funding for purchasing of Narcan to provide Barnstable County's 7 regional emergency shelters with a medical supply that will treat potential drug overdose victims at each site as presented.
So moved.
Second.
I'm getting a nod. I did okay, right?
You're great.
It's been moved and seconded. Any questions on this one?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, this is one for the Cape Cod Commission now in the town of Mashpee. I'm looking for someone to move to authorize the execution of a memorandum of agreement by acting by and through the Cape Cod Commission with the town of Mashpee in the amount of $450,000 for a period of the execution through December 31st, 2019 to utilize nitrogen reduction mitigation funds to support the design of its proposed wastewater treatment plant as presented.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. We still have staff here. Are there any questions on this one?
Yes.
I have one too, but go ahead, Ron.
We'll let him ask the question, then I'll answer it. Or do you want me to answer it for us? Go ahead.
Yeah, so.
You have it in front of me.
I got no, I mean, I understand.
Yeah, he has it.
I understand what, in general, what it is that they're doing here, but could you give me like a, some clarification how it works with impact fees and that, like how much you have, is it broken down by town?
Sure.
Why don't you come up here, Ms. Senatore, please.
Thanks, Christy Senatore, Acting Director for the Commission. These are DRI mitigation funds that have been collected in the past based on projects that have been implemented or in the town of Mashpee, and these are funds that are held for the town, and they can use them when it becomes applicable and appropriate. So these are funds that they have requested, and they're made available to them for the purposes of nitrogen reduction. So these are mitigation funds that are available to the community.
So all right, so I think it said in here how much you're holding for the town of Mashpee. So I guess the county has these funds in accounts for the Cape, for the benefit of the Cape Cod Commission, and then and then you bring it forth whenever you want to utilize them, so on and so forth. But
they're all held for the towns, so it's mitigation funds that come in through DRI decisions. They're all held for the towns. And so when they want to utilize the funds, they request the release of those
and
funds.
And so these funds never seem to, they don't really show up in any financial statements for the commission or the town. They do.
Absolutely.
So what? So how much are you holding total, like in
approximately?
Approximately. Well, there's accounts for all 15 communities, and Gail would know that number. We could get that for
you. I can get it for you. I don't know an exact number. It's probably around $3 million.
About $3
million? Yeah. It's in a special revenue fund that earns interest, and that's allocated based on the projects that are funded.
And for the record, not only are these funds held in a separate account and for the benefit of the town, but it's also held for the benefit of a specific purpose. In other words, Town of Harwich may have $110,000 in there for sidewalks or for pedestrian things, you know. Improvements, thank you. They're even, to my knowledge, some of them are even site-specific to improvements to certain intersections.
Right.
Lighting, the ambulances being able to come through and have lightings changed in a future date when some more development happens in that area. So all this is public record. Every town has access to it, and every person has access to it, and they certainly can go on the, I believe it's all on the web, right?
Yep, it's all available.
So that they can see, you know, what is in there. I know because a number of people from Harwich have asked me if there have been any mitigation funds set aside for specific areas in Harwich. So each town does have a running balance.
I just have a question.
Yep.
Does this wastewater treatment plant cover the entire town or just a portion?
I believe this is a portion.
A portion.
Okay. We have a motion on the floor to approve this. It is a allocation of $450,000. Coming from the town of Mashpee's mitigation funds at the Cape Cod Commission, and it's for the purposes to support a design for its proposed wastewater treatment plant.
So moved.
Second.
It has been moved. And seconded.
Aye.
I'm looking for a vote.
Yes.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you guys for staying.
I know there
was a question on that. I'm going to go to commissioners' reports now. Is there anything in commissioners' reports? Mr. Beattie, do you have anything?
Yeah, I've been worrying about and working on the AmeriCorps housing issue, so and I just contacted something, I happen to recall something with the town of Barnstable that hadn't been thought of before, so I've put the AmeriCorps staff in contact with my contact with the town of Barnstable, so there's a possibility, another possibility that they might be able to be housed in Barnstable at a certain location. So it is being worked on. I know there were a number of people that were here earlier. So it's actively being worked on both by the department and commissioners and the administration, just so people are aware of that.
So they're losing the Bourne House.
They're going to lose the Bourne House.
Right.
But they've been working at it. I contacted one of the town councils, Phil Wallace, this morning because I happen to remember a building called the Payne Black House.
Yeah, let's not get into it. It's not on the agenda. It's just good enough that you're working on it.
Yeah,
I mean, and I think AmeriCorps staff needs to know that we're all working on it. And I just will say for the record, if anybody has any suggestions, contact our facilities director. They're the ones that have to really approve anything to make sure before we start housing people anywhere for safety and you got nothing else to do anyhow.
So that's about all I have to report.
Do you have anything? Okay, the only thing I have is I want to give you a heads up. Next week is going to be a very important meeting. I'm going to be scheduling an executive session next week to finalize the contract negotiations with our acting director of the Cape Cod Commission. So it really needs to be done because, again, the starting date was, I believe we said February 5th, so we're running a little late on that, and I apologize. That has been from my inability just to sit down and review stuff and bring together the contract. So that will be on next week, and we'll probably have some other updates for you, too, now that we're out of budget season next week. So, Jack, do you have anything for us under your administrator's report?
Nothing new.
Mr. Facilities Director, do you have anything under your report?
No, I don't do anything.
Okay. Can I ask maybe just where the dredge is? Did it make it yet? Is it on its way?
No.
Okay. But it's close. I mean, we've
It's up.
Actually, I do have just one update on.
I know we were waiting because of scheduling with moving the other one and stuff like that, but there's no problems. It's just we're kind of waiting for a window
We are up against a window of a deadline for problem sound, so that's where they're trying to just focus all the efforts to get that up and running, and then they will move the new dredge from Fairhaven down to Falmouth. So we're just waiting for a window of opportunity. Last week we had some issues with weather and wind and tides. The other thing I just want to keep you guys in the loop on is the new conference space is progressing. All the sheetrock is up, it's painted. We're just waiting for the bids to come back on the HVAC work and some rough plumbing. So we're hoping to have those bids in this week, I believe. And then we'll award, they'll be in front of you hopefully next week, and we'll award them. And it's a short period of time. It's the way the conference center is set up, it's pretty straightforward on the HVAC. It's probably like a week and a half to 2 weeks to put it in. It's just everything's open ceiling, put it in, and then we'll put the ceiling in. So we're hoping to have that kind of up and running, you know, within the next couple of months. So I just want to keep you guys
in the loop. Can I just clarify something on that? Mm-hmm. So the new conference space will be the permanent home for the Assembly of Delegates, or are they going to use
that? I wouldn't say permanent.
You wouldn't say permanent.
No, so the intention they run is we're going to use the Duke Conference space is essentially double the size of the old Harborview. So we have some money within our budget to improve the Harborview. And what I mean by improve is just take down the columns that currently restrict the Harborview. So I think what we're going to end up doing is kind of switching operations to the larger conference center. And then once that's done, I think that the future home for the Assembly and possibly the commission would be in the current Harborview room.
Once it's improved.
Once it's improved.
So you're doing like a juggling act.
So like it's going to be one of those back and forths. I think that's the best way to describe it. And then depending on, you know, I know some of the meetings that Assembly has, they need the room for more people. So I think it would be an adjustment on what's on the protocol. Like the last time with the sheriff being there, we ran out of room. This new space would accommodate all that space. But I don't think we need to use that big of a space every week just for their meeting.
And the same thing with the Cape Cod Commission.
Right.
Yep. They
so I think it's I think it'd be a judgment call on whoever's assigned the meeting.
They obviously will have their choice to use the smaller one or the bigger one.
Right. I think they know when you put the agenda out, you guys have a pretty good working knowledge of how many people are going to show up.
Every now and then we get blindsided.
Right.
So the Assembly is going to be over at the Harborview maybe in March or something like
their
that?
Their first meeting is scheduled for March. The first meeting in March is scheduled at the Harborview.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
No problem, Chief.
It's 11:15, and we still have two items that have to be completed. We're waiting for staff to do the numbers. I'm going to ask for a brief recess, and why don't we come back, and let's give them 10 minutes. We'll come back at 20 past 11 and return, okay? So I'm going to recess for 10 minutes. Thank you. I'm going to call the meeting back to order. This is the February 7th, 2018 meeting of the Regional Commissioners. We began the meeting at 10 a.m., went through a lengthy agenda. There are two items that we were unable to complete, so we took a short recess. It is now 20 past 11. And we're going to reconvene for the purposes of voting items 7C and D. So I'm looking for someone to move the approved proposed ordinance 18- to be numbered, adopting the Barnstable County's operating budget for fiscal year FY 2019 in the amount of $27,354,113 and authorize its forwarding to the Assembly of Delegates for review and vote as presented.
So moved.
Second.
That's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on this? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That brings us to D. I'm looking for someone to move the proposed ordinance 18- to be numbered, adopting Barnstable County's Enterprise Fund operating budget for fiscal year 2019 in the amount of $2,026,000.
So moved.
And authorize it forwarding to the Assembly of Delegates for review and vote as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. For those of you listening at home and those of you who don't know, this is the Enterprise Fund, which is actually the dredge. We do this a separate ordinance for that. Any discussions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. That concludes the business of the day. If there's anything else, I ask that you, let me go to our, we've already done our reports. So basically, I'd be looking for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and second to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you very much.